We see how, as I just explained, austerity is deployed by the elite running state institutions, from central banks to the treasury to other institutions that make up the state, how austerity is functioning once more to eliminate class consciousness and to thus foreclose alternatives to capitalism. And this happens in two ways. It happens both through, of course, the macroeconomic management, but it also happens through the ideas that are spread in order to justify and rationalize the extraction of resources from the majority of the people. And this is the big role that economists have played, especially pure economics, as this new science that is actually proposed in the moment of greatest class conflict after the First World War. It is in this moment as the science spreads. It is not by chance, because it is indeed the moment in which theory had to be functional to the system by saying, we have to see the world differently, workers do not count, who counts is only the saber investor. Classes do not matter, we're only all individuals. And of course, there is no conflict. We should all be understanding the harmony that comes from privileging private investment. So this combination of coercion and consensus make up the backbone of the austerity project. Now, this austerity project, what you find out, is that was best developed and brought to its most efficient application by the first fascist dictatorship in the world, of Benito Mussolini, who came to power in October of 1922. It was not a coup, it was actually a deliberate decision of the from the part of the governing elite, especially the liberal elite, to bring to power a man who was strong enough in wielding the oppressive state power to pass austerity policies. So what we see historically is that fascism is the best student of austerity, and that ultimately how fascism is, of course, the form of government that is best suited to defend the capital order. And in this, it's not me saying this out of the blue, it's actually the historical data that shows how in 1922, it was primarily the liberal elite that was writing about how wonderful it was to have the opportunity to have Mussolini in government in order to privatize, to stop the exaggerated demands from workers, to increase profit expectations, and to ultimately stabilize the capital order. So again, Mussolini, the best friend of the Bank of England, the British Treasury, the J.P. Morgan, the Jacob Morgan, the bank, this was a moment in which fascism was really understood as the solution to the existential crisis of the capital order. Now, of course, what is interesting to note is not only that fascism is very efficient in wielding austerity and saving the system, it is also the case that once austerity is put into operation, renewed phases of fascism more easily come about. Indeed, fascism is also the expression of the success of austerity, because by individualizing us, by making us more precarious, by making us without any capacity to think beyond capitalism, what happens is what we see all around the globe right now: the rise of authoritarian, right-wing, xenophobic, fascistic governments, from, of course, Donald Trump to Bolsonaro to Giorgia Meloni to many others that we can think of. And this is indeed what austerity produces, an incapacity to actually think according to one's own interest as people, and instead buy into the interest of those who benefit from the capital order. So this is the vicious circle of fascism implementing austerity very well, but also fascism being the product of these waves of austerity.